Hey Bombini everybody, Matt here from the Cruise Geeks, hanging out today with my cousin Rowan, and we are out looking for some cruise creatures. Rowan, where are we at?
We are in Millennial Park in Seminole, Florida.
Yeah, so we're gonna see what kind of trouble we can get into, see if we can hunt down some creatures for you guys to check out. So tag along. We followed there's a lot of really slick, deep mud. We followed a kayak trail out here from the park under the boardwalk. And you can actually, well, you can't see it from here, but there is a, there's an overlook and stuff. But actually where we're at is just kind of your basic sort of mud flat that you would find. Now we're in Florida, but you could find similar types of habitats in a lot of places in the Caribbean. I think Rowan has got one of those crown conchs. Let's check it out. Got one there, Rowan? Let's see if I can get that in focus. Nice. So this is a snail, and you can kind of see why it's called a crown conch if you look at the top of the shell. Yeah, you can see it's called a crown conch. When it was born, it hatched out of an egg, and it was just this little tiny thing. And as it's grown, it's gotten progressively bigger. And these will get a little bigger than this, too. But yeah, good find, Rowan. Crown conch. It's a snail, basically. Snailed it!
Get a hold of the coconut and get out of there.
All right, Rowan just came back from a little expedition. Rowan, what did you get here?
I found a very large conch, and we've been finding other ones, lots of them, but
lots of little ones.
This one's much bigger.
This is the biggest king crown conch I have ever seen. And I don't mean like it's like a couple centimeters bigger. I'm talking like the biggest one I've ever seen was probably like this big. This is the monster. This is the Mac Daddy of King Crown Conchs, but very cool.
What's that? Is that
That's the bottom of his foot. I don't think that's an orifice, although it might be. I'm not 100% sure.
There's like some stuff in there. That's a part of his flesh, or whatever.
Yeah, so his mouth, his eyes are all going to come out here. This might be just an opening to get water into the mantle so that the animal can breathe and stuff. This little piece here is called the operculum, so this will close up like a little door if this animal is truly feeling threatened, and they can keep all the soft part of their body inside the shell to kind of protect them. But apparently that one likes you a little bit at least.
Yeah.
Nice find. King crown conch. And a coconut.
Yeah, I bet.
Now, if you don't ever put the lime in the coconut and drink them both up, because then it'll make you sick. All right, let's see what else we can find. Now, there's a lot here, but most of it's pretty small. We've seen some polychaete worms, which are basically annelid worms or segmented worms. Mostly we've seen their evidence. So see if I can show you some of that here. And this is something you might see. Let me get out of the sun. If you look right down in this area, it usually looks like a little mound, and there's something coming out almost like you're squeezing toothpaste. What that is actually gonna be that worm feeding, and it's feeding on the detritus and stuff, that dead stuff that's in the sand, algae in the sand. It's passing through its body and coming out. Yes, that is worm poop, ladies and gentlemen. But mostly it's sand. Now, there's some other things here too, and Rowan's just found another one here I can see. And this is kind of a gelatinous blob. Now, this could be a couple of things. Sometimes some of these polychaete worms will produce these to have things get stuck in them. Then they can pull them down inside because they live in little holes, and they can get food. Sometimes those are the eggs of those animals as well. Just depends on which one we're talking about. Now out here in the mud flats, you are gonna see some trees, and there are two kinds of trees that we're seeing today. Those are both different species of mangrove trees, red and black mangrove trees. There are three in Florida. The third one is the white mangrove. The way it works is the white mangroves are the least tolerant of the salty water, and then black mangroves are a little more tolerant, and red mangroves are the most tolerant. And you can tell these apart, especially the black and red are super easy. Let me just switch to this one. I have to be careful because I'm barefoot. But you see, I'm barefoot. sloshy mud. So the black mangrove trees, the leaves and everything look pretty similar, but you see these stick type structures here. These are called pneumatophores, and these are sort of how this tree respirates and can survive in this salty brackish water. Brackish being a mix of salt and fresh. Now, when we get towards the edge, we start to get these roots here, which are called prop roots. And these are from the red mangrove tree. Now, the red mangrove tree is a little more tolerant, so you'll see them out in the water a little bit more openly. And then they'll actually produce a baby tree, which is called a propagule. Now, Rowan found one earlier when I was not filming, so we'll see if we can find one again. If I do, I'll add it on. All right, so Rowan found a propagule here. Now, we were talking about the red mangrove tree, and this is what we mean by a propagule. So this is basically a baby mangrove tree, and what it's gonna do is it is bottom heavy here. So if this was in the water, it's gonna float like this, and then when this roots in, which it didn't do there, but when it sticks in there, then a new tree will actually sprout out of that. That is an actual baby mangrove tree right there, called a propagule. Rowan, what have you got right there?
It's a mold of a horseshoe crab.
Yeah, so horseshoe crabs have an exoskeleton, and when they grow, they have to get rid of their old exoskeleton. And we know that it's a molt because there's a split right up here at the top. But this is, we found a few dead ones, but this is a shed one, or a molted one. That's pretty cool. It's still fairly pliable and stuff as well. Pretty small animal right there. I see another horseshoe crab over here. This one is bigger, and I'm not sure if this is a shed one or a dead one. Oh, okay, I can tell. So, this has been here a while, so there's not much left, but see this split right here? You can really see it on this. If you find one of these and it's split like that, then you have a shed or molted exoskeleton, and if it is not split there, that's a dead. Now, we found a few horseshoe crabs that were either molted or dead, but I've got a live one here. Let's check it out. I don't know if you can see this, but I'm gonna bring it up so you can take a look. So this is a live horseshoe crab, and let's just turn it over here. You can see what it's got here. It's got 10 legs, and they've got little claws on it. You want to hold on to this for me, Rowan? It won't hurt you or nothing. I promise this time. I said that with a fiddler crab and it pinched him. Here, let's do it this way so we can get it in the sun here. So we can see it. We want the people to be able to see it. Now, the horseshoe crab, not a horseshoe, not a crab, actually closer relative of arachnids, which are spiders and scorpions, but they're not in that group either. This is the mouth right here. That's the mouth of the animal. These are the gills. These are called book gills. So they flap up and down so the animal can respirate. As long as they're wet, they're pretty good. We won't leave them out of the water for too long. And I say him because this is a boy. Now, you can tell this is a boy because these first two legs here, they look like little boxing gloves. And the females, they look just like all the other legs. So these guys are gonna go through the water. They're going to eat things like those marine worms we saw, stuff like that, right off the bottom. And they're super important because these guys have a copper-based blood, and that copper-based blood, when it has any type of infection type of property, bacteria, it kind of clots up on it. Because of that, their blood is the best way that humans have of testing medicines like insulin for impurities. So their blood's actually worth a lot of money. You can't just go out and collect it on your own though. There are special places that do that in a way that the animals survive. So they put them on this conveyor belt, they extract the blood from this crevice, you're gonna turn it upside down, or right side up actually, technically. They extract it from this crevice right here, and then the horseshoe crabs are released back into the water and they're fine. They have these big compound eyes here. They have a lot of simple eyes, not the 80s band, but actually eyes that detect light and dark. And then you saw that Telson on the back here, wagging around there. A lot of people mistake that for a stinger. It's not, it simply helps them to turn over. So Rowan, put it back in the water, but upside down. And we'll set it, let's see, we'll take it here where we haven't kicked the water up too bad. Now watch what this animal is gonna do. It's gonna use that tail, once it figures out that it's back in the water, it'll use that tail to right itself, in theory, any day now. Or maybe it decided it likes this position. You also maybe see those gills go in just a second here.
It's back two legs, like sprouts.
Yeah, so those are called swimmerettes. And they use those swimmerettes to help them swim. I don't know why this guy's not turning himself over. He's not the sharpest horseshoe crab in the box. Normally they will use this. Yeah, there you go. Turn yourself over. There you go. That's what I was expecting. He was just playing friendly. So yeah, so that is a live horseshoe crab. Pretty cool. Now the reason that the horseshoe crab has those little boxing gloves, if it's a male, is they like to hold on to the female. And they just wait for her to lay her eggs, and then they fertilize them externally. So that's what's going on here. It's probably a female with a male holding on. There's Randy and Sandy on the lookout tower. They didn't come in the water with us. Randy is my cousin and Rowan's dad. And of course you know Sandy the Geekette. So they didn't want to come out for the aquatic part of the adventure. They're hanging out up at the lookout. They're gone! What happened? Where'd they go? You guys probably saw them. Now one of the things you have to be careful of if you're in a place like this is you gotta watch things like the tide. Now we put our shoes up here and they were both sitting right here. And you can see there's only one there now. The other one is all the way over there. So I'm gonna go recover it because Rowan is still out there finding stuff. Make sure he still has shoes when we leave. All right, Rowan, we're gonna head back because I don't know how deep this water is gonna get. But listen, if you enjoyed this video of Rowan and I going out looking for cruise creatures today, make sure to give it a thumbs up so we know that you wanna see more. And also, go ahead and subscribe to the channel, hit that little bell notification so you're notified every time a new Cruise Geeks video comes out. Until next time, have a fantastic day. Say goodbye, Rowan.
Centennial, Florida. Yeah.
We're gonna do that take again.
We are in Millennium Sonorum.
Millennium Park.
Millennium Park. We are in Millennium Park.
In Seminole, Florida.
In Seminole, Florida.
All right, let's try it again.